Okay, apparently I need no introduction.
This is Adam. He's going to talk about Webmin now.
Webmin. Okay, before I start, who here knows what Webmin is?
Sort of.
Kind of, sort of. Yeah. Most people have seen it at some point, encountered it. There's no formal presentation. This is mostly going to be demo. For a variety of reasons, not least of which is I didn't have time to put together a presentation, so it's going to be mostly demo.
That means it'll be short.
hopefully it'll be somewhat shorter, unless we go off into the weeds.
When I get home early tonight.
Yeah, okay. Webmin is pretty much, well, I'm going to say counterintuitive to the highly experienced Unix user, because it removes from you all of the power of the command line. The flip side is that for the novice Linux user, well, I shouldn't say Linux, for the novice Unix user, and I'll actually show that, Webmin eliminates the need to know all of the ins and outs of the command line because it is giving you basically a GUI management system for your Unix system. The website itself says it is a web-based interface for system administration for Unix. Not Linux, Unix. This runs on Solaris, BSD, and Linux, and AIX, and HPUX, and...
Which versions of Solaris, like any?
Right up to Solaris 11. So, you can set up user accounts, Apache, DNS, file sharing, and much more. Emphasis on much more. The big deal is you don't have to learn VI, you don't have to learn the command line tools. You have to know just enough to get Webmin installed, and then you're done, basically. You could theoretically administer a Unix system 100% successfully for most of its lifespan without ever having to touch the command line. I say most because if you're running Solaris, you don't want to try and patch the system through Webmin. It does have limits. See the standard modules page for a list of all the functions built into Webmin. Let's go look at that. Standard modules. I've zoomed this in way in so that everybody can read it. ADSL, Apache, Bind, BSD, Firewall. That's the old firewall. Backup, bandwidth, boot up. You can burn CDs through Webmin. Changing passwords. Cluster support is a neat feature of Webmin. You can manage multiple systems simultaneously using Webmin. And it actually kind of sort of works. It's kind of...
Except Windows.
Well, yeah. Cluster copy files, cluster cron jobs, cluster shell... A bunch of cluster. For a poor man's cluster, it's actually not bad. Ironically, there's a module to let you run a command line shell inside Webmin. If you were going to use the command line shell, why were you using Webmin in the first place would be my question, but I guess somebody had a need for it.
If you've got a very restrictive firewall that gets you web access and not much else.
Yep, that would be a reason. There are some good reasons to run Webmin, even if you do know the command line. Setting up packages like Dovecot. I see a few people shudder in the audience. With its 6 million bloody options, a GUI is not always a bad thing. Especially if the GUI is decent, and usually the Webmin modules are pretty decent. I mean, this just goes on and on and on and on. And this is just the built-in standard list of modules. This doesn't cover the third-party extensions. NFS experts versus NFS v4 experts versus HPUX NFS exports. So it covers a lot of ground.
Ooh, SCO Unix.
Okay, well, it covers a lot of obsolete ground, too. But, I mean, you can actually edit partitions using Webmin. It's a little scary, but you can do it. There's SQL database management modules.
Worm modules.
There's what, sorry?
That's pretty cool.
Oh, yeah, that's a CPAN interface.
Yeah.
CPAN web interface. So, really, you can live your entire life inside Webmin.
Text plugin.
Yep. And that was at least the second way to do command line tasks from inside Webmin. As Gilbert said, you know, if you've got a restrictive firewall, but you can get web port 80 through it, or 443, or whatever port through it, you can iSCSI. Actually, one of the things I've used it for, still talking about it in general, is... No, it's not file manager. There's, I don't know where it is in this list. There's a file editor built into Webmin.
Mm-hmm.
So I've installed all of Webmin and then set the default page and locked it down so that the only thing a user can access is editing one file. And what did I do that for? I did that for a DHCP server once. So that was how I made a DHCP appliance, quote-unquote. Was I set Webmin up and told and let it edit.
It's a nice hack.
One file.
Why not?
And as far as I know, that particular client is still running OpenBSD, like version 4.something. And it just keeps going and going and going. So going back a page here. How do you get Webmin onto your system? RPM file, Debian package, good old-fashioned tar file, or Solaris package?
Is that like OpenCSW?
Let's have a look. No, no, I don't actually want to download it right at this instant. No, it's a .pkg file, so Solaris native package format. So you don't even need the CSW stuff installed to install Webmin.
And for Debian and RPM, obviously you just use the standard package name.
Yep.
But for a Solaris package, I guess you have to uninstall and reinstall the new version?
That's a good question.
Solaris packages for whatever reason. But.
It's a good question. Webmin's normally really good at upgrading itself.
Is it?
If you use the tar file, the whole thing's written in Perl.
Mm.
So as long as you've got Perl, you can run the source distribution.
Mm.
So let's... this is an OpenBSD. It's actually not 6.0. It's the 6.1 snapshot. But for our purposes, it doesn't make a lot of difference. Copy link address. We'll start with the tar file, and I will demonstrate just how easy it is to install. And it's not a little itty-bitty package, but it's not a ginormous monster like some other packages are nowadays. Unfortunately, this is running under Hyper-V, so disk access is a little on the slow side. Vroom. Vroom, vroom.
Is there any cost to all this?
Zip, zilch, nada, free. In certain areas of Webmin, you get what you pay for. The core functionality is pretty solid. It's been around for... I'd have to look at the history, but it's been around for a long time. Because I remember Webmin on like Red Hat 3 systems. Sorry? Yeah, you're right. So it's like over 15 years old. And under pretty much continuous development.
One must be in awe of the potential of this, the damage of your system.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So, do you have any stories to tell us about that?
Actually, I have never managed to completely mulch my system using Webmin. I don't know if it's a combination of knowing what I was doing and having an understanding of what clicking that button is going to do and just getting lucky, but I've never destroyed a system using it.
Is there any way to back out of what you've done? Does it record what you've done?
There is, actually. And where's the install file? In a second. Install module. Where's setup? Webman. There's supposed to be a setup file in here. Downloads. Current Webman. Installing the tar file. Get it? Huh. Did I just miss it?
Setup.sh
is okay. So this is the tar file, which will step us through the config. Is that readable for everybody?
Yep.
More or less? Okay. etc webmin, var webmin, wants Perl. And it says no.
Oh.
Okay. That's... Naturally, I tested this on 6.0, not the 6.0 snapshot. Crap. Moving on to CentOS. That was unfortunate. Copy. Okay.
You need to scroll down the edge.
I do. Debian, okay. The gods of live demo are frowning upon me today. That was remarkably fast. This is a DigitalOcean droplet, so it has substantially better connectivity than this laptop.
The gods heard your disparagement.
Sorry?
The gods heard your disparagement. They gave you fast internet.
Although, even on an SSD-backed droplet, it's still taking a minute to unpack and install. Okay.
So the stuff, there's a bunch of cluster stuff. Is that clusters as defined by Webmin? Or is there some sort of other cluster that it's referring to?
Okay, this might be a real short presentation.
Do you want
to... I swear to God, this was not happening like 2 hours ago.
What if you just use the repo?
That is what I'm going to do?
I can't force it.
Oh.
Well, yeah.
No, it's because I had it half installed.
Well, it was cached because you just installed it locally.
Bloody hell. There is a repo. Dpackage install. So I should be able to do that. Fine. I must have chosen the wrong version of Debian when I recreated the droplet or something. Honest, I did test this. So it takes a moment. /154 There we go. Webmin install complete. You can now log in to blah, 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 blah. Port 10,000 is the default. This is what happens when it's running in SSL mode, but you don't type HTTPS. That's configurable. You can have it auto-redirect if you want. So the usual, your connection's not private, blah, blah, blah. Log into Webmin. By default, it'll use PAM authentication on Linux. You can also tell Webmin to authenticate using its own internal user database, if it's running as root. No, not now. System host name. So, are the graphs visible? Kind of, sort of?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, wow, they've actually... And this is also not the version I got earlier today. That's cool. So, can you tell what happened? Well, you can back up config files. Each module is responsible for knowing how to back up the files that it's going to touch. So you can do that. And then for an audit trail, you have the Webmin's actions log, which right now should be pretty much empty. Yeah, because I haven't actually done anything yet. If I go look at the system boot up and shutdown, for those of you who absolutely hate typing systemctl space enable space something 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 dot service, here's a GUI for you to manage the same thing without all the typing. Of course, now you have to do just as much clicking, but some people prefer the clicking. It'll actually show you the script, the init script for each process or for each service. So you can actually look at what's going on and start the boot time, yes, no, save, start, restart, show status, stop, delete. Let's show status. Show status. If I was running this on Solaris, it understands the SVCS command and it uses that to show status. And SVCCFG to configure the services. If I was running on CentOS 6, it would understand check config and service. So it adapts to which system you're on. Actually, let's go to Webmin configuration. So here's all the things you can configure about Webmin itself. Just a handful. You know, there's not a lot of configuration options in here.
There's an upgrade.
Yes, there is. So, operating system and environment. Operating system, according to Webmin, is these. This is the list of operating systems that it can detect and knows something about. PlayStation Linux.
Huh.
Okay. Irix for the diehards among you.
Mm-hmm. Solaris is under Oracle or Sun Solaris? Is there an Oracle Solaris? Oracle Enterprise Linux.
Nope, so it's Sun Solaris.
Mm-hmm. Turbo Linux.
Yeah.
As I said, Wind River. Hey, Yellow Dog is in here. Come on. So,
there's no excuse to not administer your old machines.
Absolutely. Internally, this is the number of different OSs that actually require different code in Webmin. So there's still a lot of, I mean, I'm pretty sure nobody's actually still administering a DEC OSF 1 system using Webmin, but the code's still there in case you have to.
Not deprecated yet.
I'm sure there's quite a lot of bit rot in that code, but, you know, technically it was never deprecated. Cobalt Linux, again, like, so the nice thing is that this goes forwards and backwards. It goes backwards into the mists of time, but it's also kept up to date for the latest and greatest, like current versions of OpenBSD, current version of FreeBSD, current version of NetBSD, current version of Gentoo, current version of CentOS, current version of Red Hat, Oracle, SUSE, etc., are all as well supported as DECOS F1. detected, and what version? Because of course there's different version, different code paths depending on which version of the OS you're running. So we can configure quite a lot of things. Let's go look at, so boot up and shutdown was one useful one. Change passwords, okay. Disk and network file systems, so we're basically managing etcfs tab here. Again, you know, a nice GUI. It's not giving you any power that an editor wouldn't, but it's saving you from having to memorize all of the options for every file system under the sun when you go to edit fstab by hand. If I really want to change stuff, click. The graphical interface is slightly old school. As you can tell by the myriad radio button options. But here we go. Mount options. So that mount options list down at the bottom will vary depending on the file system type you've selected. And it is not 100% exhaustive. There's still stuff that you need to read the man page for. But by and large, that's certainly all the common things you would need to edit. Log file rotation. This is stuff that I don't even bother fiddling with from the command line because it's such a pain. I don't go and edit logrotate.d config files. Does anybody here?
No.
Okay. All right, fine. Does anybody complain bitterly every time they have to edit a logrotate.d file?
No, I don't have to do that.
Yeah, okay. But like the post-rotate command. How often have I forgotten a post-rotate command? Well, this is going to remind me about the post-rotate command because it's right there on screen in front of me. I think they were a little bit brave in including this section.
The fact that there is a warning that says, open like five shells before you do this. You let yourself back in.
Yep. Scheduled commands. Whoops, that's at. Scheduled cron jobs is what I wanted. So there's not much in the default cron on a Debian system out of the box. But for those of you who absolutely hate remembering which version of cron you're running and what the correct cron file syntax is on that version of cron on that particular OS, because it's different on every OS, in case you haven't done cross-OS management, here's your nice common GUI to manage it. Software package updates. So this works. This actually works well on Linux. And FreeBSD. This is showing me the this is the equivalent of apt-get update, apt-get upgrade. I can actually manage that from a GUI. Now, all of these things that I've talked about, there's GUIs out there that let you manage. The point of Webmin is that it is one overarching system that manages pretty much everything. And while it's not necessarily best of breed for managing any single thing, it's all in a single unified framework. So you only have to set up your authentication once. You only have to set up audit logging once. You only have to set up, you know, your SSL certs once. You only have to set up blank once, and you've got it now set up for every module and every function. Sorry.
Another big plus is if you're managing multiple different system types, you've got a consistent interface.
Yep. I had hoped to demonstrate the fact that Webmin on OpenBSD, Webmin on CentOS, and Webmin on Debian are all functionally identical. We're looking at Debian tonight, because that's where it worked. Kevin?
Is Webmin's focus one web server per server? Like, is there any way to bulk manage a bunch of servers?
Yes, there is. Yeah.
That's what I asked before, but I...
Yes, but I ignored you.
So these are Webmin clusters.
Yes.
So you can tell it these systems should all be treated as a blob and do everything the same blob.
Different modules have different levels of support for clusterness.
Yeah.
Some, like for example, bind. If you set up bind and you inform it that there's a cluster of servers here, when you go to create a primary zone on one server, it can automatically create the slave zones on all the other servers for you. So that's a somewhat well integrated cluster management module.
You just set up like a system specifically, if you could do the cluster thing, you set up one specifically and say manage all these servers, or is that just
actually one? you can go to any of the Webmin servers and manage any of them from any of them
after you set up the cluster, I guess, or?
Yes, so, yeah,
so they all get informed that they're part of such and such a cluster,
yep.
And therefore you can go to any one of them and...
For all intents and purposes, what you see behaves like a multiple master cluster where it doesn't matter which one you're doing the administration from.
Mm-hmm.
Behind the scenes, it depends on what function you're executing. For example, cluster copy files, cluster cron jobs, cluster users and groups, that actually is sort of multi-master. Whichever system you do the change on, it propagates to all the systems simultaneously.
Mm-hmm.
Using the bind DNS server example, regardless of which server you've done, regardless of which server you're connected to, you're choosing one of those servers to be the master server, and that server will get the master zone file created. And the server, that creation of the master zone file happens through Webmin on that server, and then it propagates changes to the slave servers from there. So it sort of trombones through whichever server it has to get its job done.
Mm-hmm.
So now what you can see here is the list of full-on cluster modules is relatively small. Passwords, files, cron jobs, shell commands, software packages, user min servers, which I'm not getting into tonight. That's a whole nother topic.
What is software package? For example, what would software packages do if you had like six servers you want to manage as a cluster, but they don't all have the same packages installed? Like, is there a way to list and say, well, which servers have which differences, and then make them all the same as this one, sort of thing, or anything like that? I'm just wondering how it manages that. Which packages are installed to begin with? So.
Note the button I'm hovering over.
Compare servers. There you go.
And I cannot easily show this right at the moment. But I believe that, yes, one of the options is now bring them into sync.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure you can.
That's okay. There's some kind of functionality for that. So
yes, there is.
That's good enough.
There is. And you can refresh package lists on all hosts simultaneously. One area where this will eventually break down is trying to, say, manage software packages across multiple OSs that are part of a cluster. Yeah, your mileage may vary when you start doing crazy stuff. Yeah, you can push this too far.
Yeah.
And that would be an example of pushing it too far. But if they're all APT-based, at least, like you could manage Debian and Ubuntu packages simultaneously here. That may or may not be a good idea, but you could. And you could say, well, go and install this deb file, and it would install across all of your Debian and Ubuntu systems simultaneously, including multiple versions of Debian and multiple versions of Ubuntu. So, again, just because you can doesn't mean you should.
Yeah.
But if you're managing a bunch of similar systems, yeah, this is a relatively easy way to broadcast a package to, you know, the 20 database servers in your cluster.
Awesome.
Excuse me for a moment. Turn on presentation settings so it'll stop going to sleep. Cluster users and groups, obviously, is... And you'll note that on each cluster screen, I have to tell it what servers to add. So it's not just automatically going to go out and start unexpectedly cluster managing servers on you, even if you've got multiple webmin servers on the same subnet. It's not gonna walk around and stab you in the back that way. You have to shoot yourself in the foot. And cluster using groups. I like this button. Because often enough, if you've only got, say, three machines in a cluster, you don't want to set up LDAP just for three machines.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to set up NIS, well, period. how do you keep your users and groups in sync? Well, use something like this. It's a lot better than RDIST for etc password. That's the old way to do it, and let's please never do that again. This is actually intelligently doing like a multi-way merge. So if you've created Adam on server A and, well, I guess technically I should be using Alice on server A and Bob on server B, it'll replicate both of those accounts to each other. Now, again, you can go off into the weeds. If Alice is UID 500 and Bob is UID 500, well, you can tell it how to handle that. You can tell it to overwrite. You can tell it to just increment and use the next available UID and preserve the username. Or you can tell it to overwrite Bob with Alice. There's different merge strategies for when you've got conflicts. But the idea is if you don't have conflicts, this is a handy tool to just one click and poof, you're back in sync. Cluster webmin servers. This is the managing webmin itself through webmin. So for example, let's go back. This one doesn't really make a lot of sense. Look at webmin configuration. Without granting root access to all your users, and without having to buy the sudo mastery book, you can. Let me just find it real quick here. Of course, I'm not finding it. There used to be users in here. Well, once you've got the users and groups created, you can control which users and groups have access to which modules. I don't want to install a module. Where do I do that from? Oh, authentication. Yeah, there's a lot of options in here. And this is perhaps the biggest downfall of webmin. is that on the one hand, they overwhelm you with options, like on this screen, but at the same time, the list of options isn't truly exhaustive. You can do more things than this by dropping to the command line, but at the same time, this is still complex enough that if you don't know what you're doing, you can still get very, very confused. So, yeah, it's a toss-up. Some of the other just random stuff that they've thrown into Webmin. HTTP tunnel. So, yes, this is going to open a web page inside an iframe proxied through Webmin.
That would let you run. That would let you open something listing on localhost only, I imagine.
Yep.
So that's probably maybe what the idea is.
I'm sure it is. But there's google.ca proxied through Webmin. So yet another way through restrictive firewalls. There's a Java file manager. Thankfully, I'm running Chrome, and I don't have Java. Pro modules is actually, I'll admit to having used this in favor of CPAN when CPAN was in a somewhat broken state on a machine of mine, and hey, it worked. Really, that's that's all I have to say about it. It worked. When CPAN was completely, when the CPAN command line tool was completely broken. So it's
but how could it do that? Wouldn't it be just doing the command lines behind the scenes for you?
Not exactly. It's loading the CPAN module, but there's a lot of functionality in the CPAN module that doesn't require the full-on interactive command line shell to be functioning. And it was something to do with readline was what was buggered up. So, the fact that the CPAN module worked meant that I could still install other stuff. The fact that readline was screwed up meant that I couldn't do it interactively. And yes, I probably could have figured out the manual command line invocation to the CPAN command to do the same thing. Or because I happened to have Webmin installed on the system for a different reason, I just typed in the module name and hit go, and it goed, so to speak. Existing modules, this is handy. This is actually non-trivial to extract out of CPAN, is what do you actually, what version of a module do you have installed? There's ways to find out, of course, but, you know, here's a nice handy tabulated list. So there's a lot of value packaged in what, at first glance, seems kind of like a silly concept. It's like, if you know your Unix system well enough to need some of these functions, why aren't you just using the command line? Well, for the same reason as, why do you use a web interface for things when you could be using a command line? Sometimes it's easier to not have to memorize really obscure command line options.
What's the second column there? I didn't catch the
version, I think.
No, no, it's not the version.
No, sub-module.
Number of submodules.
That's like a dependency tree, then, I guess, or submodule?
If I drill into SASL, there's the submodules. SASL external, SASL cram MD5, SASL Perl, SASL yada yada yada. So it's stuff that gets installed as one package, but provides a bunch of namespaces. So CPAN, what's the term? Bundles? No. No, it's a, no, it is a package. It's a CPAN package, but it's multiple Perl packages inside a CPAN package.
Multiple Perl modules.
Modules? Is that the right term?
Yeah.
Okay.
Which are packages.
I'll take your word for it. I know that there's things you can download and install from CPAN that installs multiple atomic units.
There's another word. It's like bundle or something.
Yeah. Distribution?
Distribution.
Okay.
That's it.
So CPAN distribution.
Kind of in the Linux world.
Now, There's also a third one, suggested modules. You can take this with a grain of salt. It's suggesting Authen Libwrap. Sure. Why does it need it? I don't know. It just thinks it does. Oops. System and server status. At a glance, there's your entire system at a glance. I mean, you can tell. I'm cherry picking and kind of jumping around just to give you a sense of the fact that there's not much that isn't covered by Webmin. There are gaps. There's definitely gaps. And then there's third-party modules to fill some of those gaps, but not all of those gaps. I wanted to use the NSD name server. There's no module for that. So instead, I used the NameD name server module for Webmin. I lobotomized the status checking part of it by saying, basically, use bin true as the is NameD running command. And then I just set up a cron job that ran the bind to NSD configuration migrator tool every 15 minutes. So I still was able to use Webmin to manage NSD, even though there was no support whatsoever for NSD in Webmin. That was perhaps a little bit of an extreme case. But again, it was a scenario where I wanted to provide a management interface for less technical users. And it actually worked quite well. I didn't have to go and edit zone files on a regular basis anymore. I had a UI that automatically populated the PTR records when I created an A record. Problem solved. And if you've never created an A record and forgot to create the PTR record, raise your hand now. Yeah. Oh, so you mean you've never created an A record. Okay, right. So there's you can even upload and download files from the system through here. Bandwidth monitoring, because every system has now grown to include a bandwidth monitor. I'm not going to add that. Several firewall rules must be added and a syslog configuration entry created. Fairly invasive. I can manage IP tables through here, though. At the moment, it's set to allow all. I can manage the IPv6 or IP6 tables. Same thing, allow all. Network configuration is what you would expect under networking. Network interfaces is basically exactly what you would expect. 8.0 supports bootp, strangely enough. Static config. Horrible UI, but it gives you access to everything you need to do without having to drop to the shell and edit random configuration file XYZ on distro XYZ. If you have to manage a cross-platform, let's say you've got HPUX, Solaris, CentOS 6, and Debian, that's four completely radically different ways of configuring the network interface, or set up Webmin and have one way of configuring the network interfaces. Take your pick. The utility of some of the older modules is becoming a little bit dubious. Does anybody still run NIS? Really? I thought you were deprecating it like 4 years ago. Or you're still deprecating it. Okay. TCP wrappers, meh.
We can deprecate.
What's that?
TCP wrappers, that's it.
Yes, it is. Edit disk partitions. Remember I said you can edit disk partitions? Yes, you can. You really can from inside the Webmin GUI. there's a bit of a catch-22 here, in my opinion, but, well, if you really want to edit partitions on the system that you're running this on, I guess go ahead.
Does it do LVM?
Yes, but not in that module. I think that one might be a third-party module you have to add in. IDE parameters, not SATA parameters or SCSI parameters. This is HD parm, not SD parm, but it's still there. If you have cups installed, this is also a way to bypass the mind-bendingly bad cups user interface and use Webmin instead with its slightly less bad user interface. System time includes NTP, I believe. We'll see momentarily. Time server sync. Synchronization will be done using the Unix time protocol or NTP, depending on what commands are installed and what the remote system supports. So it's going to attempt to auto-detect what you have installed, and then it's going to attempt to magically figure out the best way to set up time synchronization. So this is an area where maybe you should be dropping to the command line and editing ntpd.conf directly. Your mileage may vary. On the other hand, if you have a system that doesn't even have NTP installed, this will actually set up a cron job to synchronize time for you every minute, 5 minutes, whatever. So they've covered like pretty much all the bases. Well, not all the bases, but all the bases anyone in this room is likely to cross at any point in the next foreseeable future.
They've come across things where you set it in the web, in the GUI, and it just doesn't happen, even though it's saying it's happening? Or is it pretty good at checking it?
Nope.
What it's doing is doing it?
Nope. It's, that I've never seen. I have on very rare occasion seen the GUI make changes that are invalid to the config files.
Is it like a gracefully error or let you know about it?
Usually it says, yeah, because usually when you click save or apply in the GUI, it'll actually go out and it'll activate the change immediately. And if it failed to activate the change immediately, you will almost universally get an error message saying, you know, well, you usually actually get the error message returned from the daemon if it was able to detect the correct location for the log file. If it wasn't able to detect the correct location for the log file, it'll still tell you, you know, an error occurred, this command returned exit code 1. So you know something went wrong. You usually know what went wrong, but even if you don't know what went wrong, you still know that something bad happened. Those are usually things that get fixed pretty darn quick. The third-party modules, well, not as much. If we go look at the third-party modules... Oh, okay. Well, let's look at servers. IRC, Amanda, Apache, Asterisk, bind 9 DNS instead of the standard bind 8 DNS. Bacula, more DNS, Big Brother, more DNS. There's a pattern here. like some of these haven't been updated since 2008.
Oh, another one above is even better.
No, I didn't even notice that one. Well, on the other hand, many of them are updated pretty just about as regularly or more so than Webmin modules, the core modules themselves. It's you know, you get what you pay for and do your own due diligence on the third-party modules before you commit to using them in production, before you commit to having a system that relies on them in production. But a lot of the third-party modules fill in gaps that are, well, that are gaps. Like ISC DHCP server, that's one thing that Webmin does not cover. And it's basically all the stuff from Jamie Cameron, because he's actually affiliated with the Webmin team, gets updated pretty darn regularly. Yep, dynamic DNS. So, I mean, the list goes on and on and on and on and on and on and on. This is only one category of third-party modules. And it just keeps going. So, I've got a sore throat, so I'm not going to stand here and keep talking too much longer. Questions?
Well, how prevalent do you think this is?
Once upon a time, it was installed by default on every Red Hat Linux box. Those days are gone because it was considered too big a security hole. Because by default, it wasn't secured properly. Surprise, back in the bad old days.
I imagine the more and more robust this gets, the more following it gets, it could supersede the command line eventually.
Mm-hmm. I would say it won't, just because there's too many diehards.
Yeah, but that's the generation.
There's a lot of one-off systems that get built that you inherit a bit of it like this just because it's a one-off. It's a very specialized machine.
Yeah.
You need to know the command line interface.
By the same token, usually my one-off systems are the ones that do get Webmin installed. And not my regular mainstream systems. It's certainly not rare. On the other hand, it's certainly nowhere near ubiquitous either. It's reasonably common. I mean, you go into any shop and I'd say 50-50 odds that there's some server somewhere in the organization that has this installed. Certainly not every organization. That's why I said maybe 50-50 odds. Dobert, do you know of any systems in your shop that have it?
That have? No.
Okay, so you're the 50% that doesn't.
Yeah.
Whether you know it or not, I know your shop does.
Not anymore. I think they're all gone if they did have it.
Yeah?
Pretty sure, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of them still have HP System Management homepage.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Sadly, that is sometimes the more efficient process.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you want to add a printer? You can only do it there.
Yeah. Or you can do it here.
Yeah. How tolerant is it if you go, say, DHCP, for instance, if you go out and manually edit, rearrange the contents or the bit, how tolerant is it of outside forces making changes to the configs?
Depends on the module.
So each has their own kind of, they parse the best they can.
The easier the config file is to parse, the more likely the module will correctly 100% of the time pick up the changes and parse it correctly.
It doesn't mark the files, it checks on them or anything like that, to check for tampering and turn.
No, it actually rereads and reparses the file every time you go to that page. Which is good and bad. Depends on what you want. Any other questions? No? Well, I hope I've given you a little bit of the flavor of Webmin, shown you what it's all about, what it can do. That was my goal tonight, to introduce the product to those of you who are so old that you've dismissed it 10 years ago, or so new that you haven't run into it yet.
Does it do send mail?
Yes, it does.
Or built in, or is it only third party?
I'm pretty sure that's part of the core modules.
He was watching the send mail service. That postfix it was watching.
ninety-nine point 9% sure it does. Yep. Core module.
Yeah.
So, yes, built in. So even Trevor can be happy.
Max will do the wacky stuff that I'm doing.
No, unfortunately, actually, I don't remember if it uses the M4 or the... Does it, I can't remember if this uses the MC or the CF. I don't. I can't. It can't use the CF directly. No, they're not that crazy.
Well, Section 10 says adding sentinel features.
I know.
So I'm assuming the.
That's yeah.
See.
I don't know.
Possibly, but edit manually. Even try humans.
I don't even see it. I had a few extra ones back anyway. See it commands. There's some stuff the MC doesn't do yet. Yeah. It's even on the mod server. It's to do with turning on authentication, turning it off.
Yeah, a few little local overheads.
You know, that was the first O'Reilly book I ever bought. Was that 600-page tome, Managing Sendmail. And that was the reason I started immediately using XIM. So, yeah, I don't know. It looks like it actually does some stuff without the M4 files. It's entirely possible that it only manages, like, really basic stuff until you point it at the M4 files. And then it can manage the more advanced stuff. It's kind of how that reads to me. Anything else?
Thanks, Adam.